So this is a different audience than I normally speak to. And how it came about, I'm at MIT, and I was at the, I usually go to services at the Hillel at MIT, and Rabbi Fisher asked me this year if I'd be willing to give a little talk on Rosh Hashanah, which is traditional to invite a faculty member to do that. And apparently word got back to Dan Judson that it was an interesting talk, and he thought maybe it would, people here would be interested in hearing that. So I will give that talk. But before that, I thought, given the nature of the audience, I should tell a few Jewish astronaut stories. And I'll begin just with when I applied. Actually, a few people asked me, did I want to be an astronaut ever since I was a little kid? I grew up in New York City. My dad used to take me to the planetarium. I'm old enough that I was a kid even before Sputnik, but there was all this talk about the coming of the space age, and of course when the first astronauts started to fly, all the little kids, well at least the, back then it was little boys, but things have changed luckily, but in any case, sure, I wanted to be an astronaut, but all the early astronauts were military test pilots. And that wasn't something I was interested in, but maybe it was my love of the stars and space led me to study astronomy, and so I have a PhD in astrophysics from Harvard, and that's what I was doing at MIT in the mid to late 1970s, which was around the time that NASA was making preparations to start flying what was then the brand new space shuttle. And the great thing about the space shuttle, from my point of view, was it had a crew of seven, and they only needed two pilots, and that opened up the selection process to scientists, engineers, medical doctors. So I put in my application. There were about 10,000 people who applied. So now my wife didn't really understand what we were getting into, which is probably a good thing. But she's a librarian and a voracious reader. And while we were in the middle of the selection process, I remember sitting, we were living in Weston at the time, I was working at MIT. We were sitting in the living room, she was reading a book, burst out laughing. I said, well, what's so funny? Well, you gotta read this. Well, the book was called Growing Up Rich, about Jewish life in New York City. And the author, Ann Bernays, wrote something as follows. She said, There are so many Jews in New York City that it's impossible to make a generalization about them, because Jews do all sorts of things, and to try to generalize about Jews in New York City would be like trying to generalize about Japanese in Tokyo or Chinese in Shanghai. About the only thing that you can generalize about New York Jews is that no New York Jews ever has been or will be an astronaut. So after I got selected, I wrote to her, and she said, first of all, congratulations, and if I ever bring out a second edition of the book, I'll obviously have to make a change. So we moved to Houston, joined a synagogue down in the Clear Lake area, which is actually near the Johnson Space Center. It's about 30 miles south of Houston, the center of Houston. And when I was getting ready to start flying, the rabbi asked if I was interested in taking any Jewish artifacts with me, which I was. I thought it would be a nice recognition of what to me was a rather unique confluence of one of the oldest human traditions, Judaism, which has been around for thousands of years, with the newest space flight. So he put me in touch with some Jewish artisans, and I have on all of my flights taken several mezuzahs, as well as two atarots, which were then attached to the talises, which my sons used for their bar mitzvahs. I took, when we were getting ready to go up for the Hubble mission. It turned out that that was right during Hanukkah, and I had been in Israel the summer before, and an artisan in Jerusalem had given me a beautiful silver dreidel, which I took with me. Some of you may have seen, if you haven't seen dreidel spinning in space, you can Google Hanukkah celebration, and it was kind of neat. You just spin it, and it just keeps on spinning and spinning and spinning. And I actually had been, I had decided I wasn't going to do anything public about it, because it was a religious thing, and I felt it was private. What I didn't realize when I was spinning the dreidel, just to show it to one of my friends up there, the TV camera was live, and all of a sudden we got a call from Mission Control, Jeff, I'll bet all of America would like to know what you're doing. So if you Google it, you'll hear me give a little public spiel on Hanukkah and the celebration, and it actually got picked up by a Jewish television network in Los Angeles and got worldwide coverage. So that was kind of nice. But by that time, we had actually moved into downtown Houston at a different synagogue, and I had continued to take Jewish artifacts with me. The rabbi there asked me on several occasions, would I like actually to take a Torah into space? And I thought that would be a wonderful idea and very, very symbolic. But we are limited in mass and volume in what personal items we're allowed to take. They allow you to take 20 little personal items. So I said, you know, I can't take a big Torah into space. They won't load it on the shuttle. So he went on a search for a miniature kosher Torah. Apparently, what happened was he was on a visit to New York, met a rabbi there who in fact had purchased just such a miniaturized Torah from a scribe in Jerusalem about 25 years previously. But he told our rabbi that no, this was too special. It was not something that he wanted to part with for any amount of money, because he was saving it for a special occasion, whatever that might be. And the rabbi said, my rabbi said, well, one of my congregants is an astronaut and would like to take this Torah into space. That's what I've been waiting for, said the rabbi. And so the Torah made its way to Houston. And I thought, before actually going into the Rosh Hashanah speech that I talked about before, given that this is a special audience, I don't show the video very often, but I performed a little ceremony up there in reading from the Torah. I got one of my best friend astronaut, he was a Swiss astronaut, not Jewish, but he agreed to video the ceremony, and that's what I'd like to share with you now. So my Swiss friend, after videoing this, we were packing everything up, and he said, Jeff, I have no idea what you were doing, but it looked very impressive. we did have... I did have a mezuzah with me on that flight. On that flight, we were actually on two shifts because we had 24-hour-a-day operations, so half the crew is asleep, and we have a little sleep compartment. So now, you can't nail a mezuzah to the door, by the way, when you're in space. That would be a bad idea, right? Holes in the door and so on. So I actually set up Velcro in the little sleep compartment, and when I got up every morning, I removed the mezuzah because I figured I didn't, you know, this was for me. I didn't want to impose on whoever was going to be using the bunk, because we hot bunk, basically. They're only enough for half the crew. But one morning, apparently, I forgot and left it there. And in the middle of the day, when both crews were awake, my crew member who had been using my bunk said, hey, Jeff, that was a really nice idea, having that mezuzah there. And I said, Of course, that's Scott Horowitz, another Jewish astronaut. So we left it there for the rest of the trip. What I'd like to do now, I talked in that video here about the feelings of awe, of the beauty of seeing the Earth as you fly over it. And I want to the best of my ability, share a little bit of that with you. And I'm going to show you a short, it's about a 2.5 minute clip made by astronauts on the International Space Station of basically watching the Earth go by. And that's whenever I had people used to ask me, what do you do with your free time? Well, whenever I had free time, I just floated and looked out the window because the Earth is just, well, you'll see, it's magnificent. It's speeded up. You'll see, you're moving much, much faster in the video. When you talk about the sense of awe that I felt up there, I hope at least to some degree you understand where that comes from. It just was something I never got tired of looking at our planet. I would like to share with you now some of those remarks that I made at Rosh Hashanah, and then hopefully we'll have some time for a conversation after that's over. I was talking about the Akedah, and I'm not going to repeat a lot of that part because I think all of you are much more learned in that matter than I ever could be, except to say that I looked at it as a story of moral evolution, of the evolution of our ideas of what is required by God and what is acceptable to people. The idea being that Abraham clearly was familiar with human sacrifice, because when God asked him to sacrifice Isaac, he knew exactly what to do. It was not something that was foreign or repellent to him, as difficult a thing as it must have been to do. He knew what to do. But the evolution in moral values, as I say, I think in this audience, I prefer to skip ahead to a different type of evolution that I'm more familiar with, which is the evolution in our astrophysical concepts of the universe that we live in. Where do we come from? What is around us? And in considering this evolution of our concept of the universe, we ought to try to place ourselves in the position maybe of our remote ancestors, who would look up. Of course, they saw the stars every night when it wasn't cloudy, which we can no longer do, unfortunately, in most places on the Earth. They saw the glory of the heavens, and gradually, if you look for long enough, you, as they did, would come to perceive some order in the motion of the objects in the sky. And the simplest pattern, of course, which we see all the time, the daily rising of the sun and in the east and setting in the west, not just the sun, but the moon, the planets, the sky, everything. So it's not hard to understand why people early on assumed that our Earth was a stable point. We don't feel the Earth moving, and we were at the center of the universe, and everything else revolved around us. I mean, any intelligent person could perceive this. Now, with a little more attention to detail, you would notice that if you watch the sun set every night or rise every morning, and you looked at the stars that became visible at that time, you would notice that the sun moved with respect to the stars, and it completed a circle going all the way around the sky every year, and the moon also moved, completing a circle around the stars every month. Now, the sun has an enormous influence on the Earth. And that also was very clear. It pretty much ruled our lives back then in the days before electricity and artificial light. I mean, the difference between night and day is about as clear a difference as you can imagine. Also, after a few seasons, we would notice that the sun moves north and south in the course of a year, and that clearly influenced the seasons, which also were incredibly important in human life. And as far as the moon, I mean, if we lived anywhere near the sea, we would see the influence of the moon on the tides, and of course, women's monthly reproductive cycles. How can that somehow not have been tied to the moon? And so clearly the sun and the moon had an extraordinary influence on our planet and over human lives. And if we continued to look clearly up at the sky, we would actually notice that not only did the sun and the moon move with respect to the stars, but there were five other objects which the human eye could see which moved against the background of the stars. These are the so-called wanderers, or the planets, the visible planets: Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And we would notice that they moved through a certain band in the sky, the same band through which the sun and the moon moved. And, you know, if the sun and the moon's motion through the sky have such a great influence on human life, well, surely these other moving objects must have an important influence, hence the birth of astrology and the assignment of supernatural powers of gods to these moving objects. And by the way, we now have seven moving objects. I don't know if you've considered why seven is such a special number, why we have 7 days in a week, but that is almost certainly the reason. And then if you were living in a particularly stable and long-lived civilization like Babylonia, India, China, Egypt, people collected observations, actually, of the positions of all these moving objects over large time periods, centuries, even millennia. And so this revealed more complicated patterns, recurring behavior, which would not be evident with just shorter observations. Things like eclipses, and actually now, speaking with my astronomer hat on, we would often make jokes back in graduate school how life must have been pretty good for those astronomers back in ancient Babylon, because if you could correctly predict an eclipse, you're living on the gravy train, because that was really critical and you were in good shape and no worries about publish or perish or getting tenure or any of that stuff. And not only that, but the farther away they are, the faster they're moving away from us, which suggested that a long, long time ago, the galaxies were much closer together. And if we run back the clock as far as we're able to, in physical theory at least, then our universe must have begun in a very, very dense primordial soup that exploded in what we now call the Big Bang. And it's been expanding ever since. I was giving this talk on Rosh Hashanah, and so I reminded all of us that, among other things, Rosh Hashanah is supposed to celebrate the birthday of the world, and so that was a good occasion to, when we're talking of the Big Bang, to say not just happy birthday world, but happy birthday universe. With this conception of the Big Bang, our galaxies are all moving away from one another, but we still assumed that we were at the center of our galaxy. But astronomy moved on, and with new techniques, especially the development of radio astronomy, we were able to unravel the structure of our own Milky Way galaxy. We now believe that our solar system is actually not in the center of our galaxy, but in one of the outer spiral arms, a kind of a boring, undistinguished backwater address for humanity. But actually, what we found out is, boring though our home location may be, it's actually far safer living out here than living near the center of our galaxy, because actually the center of our galaxy is relatively quiet compared to some violent galactic centers where you have big black holes. We believe there are black holes at the center of every galaxy. Big black holes, millions or a billion times the mass of our sun, are constantly gobbling up stars and shooting out vast amounts of energy and high energy radiation. Not a nice neighborhood. Even the center of our galaxy, our black hole is much smaller and it's relatively quiet, which is a good thing for us, but still, not a nice neighborhood, and we're pretty happy out where we are now. It turns out that although the expansion of the universe looks to us like we're in the center of the universe and everything is moving away from us, this expansion would actually look the same to any observer anywhere in the universe, because what we believe is that on a large enough scale, the universe is pretty much homogeneous and isotropic, maybe with a little bit of fractal structure built in. That's another story. So it would look the same to any observer anywhere in the universe. So by the middle of the 20th century, humanity had not only been displaced from the center of the solar system, but our solar system had been displaced from the center of our galaxy, and our galaxy could no longer be considered the center of the universe. Now, something else really exciting has been happening in astronomy. It's a lot closer to home. Back in 1995, two Swiss astronomers discovered for the first time a planet revolving around another star other than our sun. And since then, astronomers have discovered thousands of planets, all around stars relatively close to our sun. And so we can do the statistics. We know now that there are more planets than stars in our galaxy, which means there are hundreds of billions of planets just in our galaxy, and hundreds of billions of galaxies that we know of in the universe, which we've seen from the Hubble Deep Field images. And that's not even the end of the story. And here's where I came to play a part personally, again, through the work that my crewmates and I did, rescuing the Hubble Space Telescope when it was first launched and it couldn't focus properly. But we installed the corrective optics, and since then, the discoveries that Hubble have made have really rewritten astronomy textbooks many times over. What I would say is the most important observation that Hubble has made in terms of our conception of the overall structure of the universe and our place in it, is related to measuring the large-scale dynamics of the structure and the expansion of our universe. When Hubble developed this concept of the expanding universe, you could sort of specify the structure with a few basic concepts that would tell you the speed and the relationship of the speed and the distance. One of the most important constants is the rate at which the expansion is slowing down. After all, if you throw a ball up from the Earth, the gravity of the Earth will slow it down. If it's not going too fast, it'll fall back down. If you throw it fast enough at escape velocity, it will leave the Earth. But in any case, it's going to slow down. The universe is filled with a lot of matter. All that matter has gravity, and it's attracting everything else. And so the gravity of everything in the universe should gradually slow down this expansion. But we didn't know how rapidly that expansion was slowing down, and that was one of the key observing tasks for the Hubble Space Telescope. And the reason Hubble was suited to do that is because the effect of this deceleration would be most visible the farther away galaxies are, and Hubble could observe galaxies much farther than other telescopes on the ground could. And so this was one of the key observing programs for the Hubble Space Telescope, and in fact, it was assigned to two independent groups so that they could each make the determination about the deceleration of the expansion, and then we would be able to compare the results. And neither group published for a long time, and everybody was wondering, what's going on? Well, the reason was because what they discovered was totally unexpected, and they couldn't believe it for a while, but they wanted to go back and check their data over and over to make sure that they weren't making some fundamental mistake, because what they found was that the expansion of the universe is not slowing down, it's actually accelerating despite all the gravity that should be slowing it down. Something must be causing this expansion to accelerate, and we've given this something a name. We call it dark energy, and it's nice to give something a name because it makes it sound like you know what you're talking about. But in fact, we don't have a clue what dark energy is. And dark energy then actually joined with what we call dark matter as an astrophysical mystery, and I won't go deeply into dark matter. It's something actually astronomers have been aware of since the middle of the 20th century in measuring the dynamics of galaxies. We became aware that you can't explain the gravitational interaction of galaxies just by the stars that we can see. There must be about five times as much matter that is interacting gravitationally, but somehow it doesn't interact electromagnetically. It doesn't emit any light, it doesn't absorb light, and so that's why it's called dark matter. We know where it is, it surrounds galaxies, and we can measure its gravitational influence, but we don't know what it is. And then, using minute fluctuations in what was discovered back in 1965 as the universal microwave background radiation, which is the leftover radiation from the Big Bang, which is almost isotropic, but not quite. There are minute fluctuations which allow us to determine how much of the content of the universe is dark energy, is dark matter, and is the regular matter out of which all of us are made. And it turns out that about 70% of the content of the universe is dark energy. And another, almost a quarter, is dark matter. We don't know what any of this is. And so I tell my students with some regret that everything that they've learned with such dedication and hard work about physics and chemistry and biology accounts for about 4% of our universe. And the rest, at the moment, we don't have a clue. So, isn't that what makes science exciting, though? Every time you answer a question, a whole bunch of new questions pop up, and certainly the search, at least for what makes up dark matter, is occupying a lot of attention now. But anyway, I want to return finally now to this theme of the evolution of humanity's concept of our place in the universe, because this really now is the ultimate Copernican revolution. We've removed humanity not only from a position that's geometrically at the center of our universe, but we've removed the very matter of which we're made from a central position in the overall content of the universe. So it's pretty humbling. And of course, there are physical and perhaps spiritual significances to all of this evolution of our concept of our place in the universe. And I'll leave that for your contemplation and perhaps for some discussion afterwards. What I want to say, though, just in closing, is we need to remember that everything that I've just described, although it's led to the concept of a universe whose time and distance are almost too vast for human contemplation, all of this is ultimately taking place inside the human brain, which is minuscule in comparison to the size of the universe. The relationship between our brains and our minds and the rest of our universe, of course, is the center of a lot of philosophical inquiry. Now I'm going to finish up just with a few images, because for me, this relationship between humans and the rest of the universe, and by the way, that's me with the red stripe on my leg, and that's the Hubble Space Telescope over at the left, This is one of my favorite pictures, floating about 400 miles above the Earth. You're really suspended between heaven and Earth, and it's just something that I'll never forget. And people sometimes ask me about whether my space flights have had any lasting spiritual consequences. And I should remind you all, we've had astronauts belonging to all the great religions of the world, Jewish, Catholic, Orthodox, Protestant, Muslim, Buddhists, Hindu, as well as atheists, agnostics, you name it. But I think one feeling that's almost universal that everybody will report is a profound sense of awe, which I mentioned before, and we were talking about in those views of the Earth. Awe in the very deepest sense of the word. I mean, we've all seen pictures of the Earth in space, and intellectually, we know what we mean when we're talking about spaceship Earth and the limitation of our planet and our resources, but somehow the totally new perspective of being able to actually see our planet from the outside, a perspective where you can actually see the sun like you've never seen it before. I'm going to let you look at this for a minute. I'm not talking about the rays coming out from it. That's an artifact of the camera lens. You've never seen the sun like this, and I had never seen it before I went into space. You're seeing the sun in a black sky, like we see the stars at night, because the sun is a star, and here you're actually seeing the sun as a star. Of course, it's close to us, so it's bigger and brighter than all the other stars, but there it is. It's totally different. And of course, you also, as an astronomer, I was always looking at the stars, and you see the entire celestial sphere every 90 minutes you go around. So I could see the northern sky at the beginning of the night, and pretty soon I'd see the southern sky, which you just can't, you got to fly a long time in an airplane from here before you can actually go down and see the southern constellations. So all of this is part of that deep sense of awe that I've described, and that sense of awe is probably a good place to stop. And as I said back on Rosh Hashanah, we refer to Rosh Hashanah as Yamim Noraim, the days of awe, and I've been talking about awe. So we've sort of come full circle, and as I said to the students back then, it was time to return from my feeling of awe in contemplating the rest of the universe from the totally new and unique perspective of space to the awe of the high holidays. And back then, I said that we should let the service continue. Here, I'll just say it's time for the conversation to begin. So I'm looking forward to some dialogue now, and I hope you've enjoyed some of the perspective that I've been able to share with you.